Sorry for the inconvenience. I welcome you all to this webinar on behalf of Mandu Cell and Mandu Foundation. Today is the International Day for Mandu Conservation. This day was declared by UNESCO in 2015 for raising the awareness regarding mangrove ecosystem and its conservation aspects. Today we have brought you the different topic of insights of mangrove conservation. Most of the webinars and lectures shed the light on different aspects of nature and its conservation need. But most of the times we are unaware about the exact work is happening in the conservation field. So we thought to bring some information for you regarding the work that we are doing at Mandu Foundation and Mandu Cell for the conservation of mangroves. Our today's first speaker is Dr. Sheetal Paspande. Dr. Sheetal Paspande, she is working with Mangrove Foundation as Assistant Director Projects, and she is a PhD holder in the field of mangroves, as well as she is a writer for many of the newspapers and magazines in which she highlights the different facts of mangroves and different aspects of mangrove conservation. Now I welcome Sheetal for the session. Hello all. Wish you all a very happy World Mangrove Day. So the today's topic on which I'll be talking on is the mangrove conservation, achieving balanced conservation and communities. So before we start about the work of mangrove conservation that we do, I would like to highlight some details about the mangrove habitats across India. So in India, at various locations, we can see the mangrove habitats. You can see in the map the locations of the mangroves. Overall, in India, 46 true mangrove species are seen. Now, it is a very strange thing when we talk about terrestrial land. There are lakhs and crores of land species that exist. But in the mangrove area, along the boundaries of our land, there are only this little number of species that exist. And along the coastline of Maharashtra, only 20 species are visible. So this also shows that Maharashtra has a great contribution in the diversity of mangroves that are seen along the coastline. This is a small pictorial illustration where we can see how mangroves are important for the livelihood, for the shelter. Leaves of mangroves are the first primary source for how the food chain starts and how the biodiversity gets attracted towards the mangroves. Mangroves are rich in variety of species that we can see, rich in bird population. They are green, evergreen, and they form a very good aesthetic. They have a very good aesthetic importance, and they have, and they exhibit a lot of ecological importance and value. Okay, so looking at the so this illustration, it shows how mangroves are a very good nursery ground for many species, and they attract various species for food requirement. This clearly indicates that less mangroves, less biodiversity. More mangroves will have more biodiversity. Apart from this, mangroves have important role, and it exhibit various ecological functions. That mangroves provide around 23% of the fisheries, like 23% of the fishing that is done, it is all mangrove dependent. Then they play an important role in water purification. Whenever you go to a mangrove forest, you will see the root system of the mangroves is very well developed. It is developed above the ground because the mangroves, they grow usually in the oxygen deprived sediment. And thus, these roots also play an important role in water purification. They attract a lot of biodiversity. The roots of mangroves hold the sediment, and that is how they help in erosion control. We recently had an experience where the cyclone was just about to hit Mumbai, and then it went towards the Raigad and other areas. And it is only because of probably we can see mangroves that very less loss compared was observed in the livelihood, and the life casualty was observed along the coastline of the Maharashtra. So mangroves can be one of the reasons that will save us from future such kind of calamities. But from all this, one very important aspect of mangroves that is usually spoken about is the carbon sequestration. So like other trees, we all know since childhood, we have been learning photosynthesis, that plants take in carbon dioxide and they make food, and that carbon is absorbed into the trees. So similarly, mangroves also absorb the carbon dioxide, but the capacity of absorbing carbon in mangroves is very high. They can absorb 40 times more carbon than any other terrestrial forest. And these carbon gets trapped into the mangrove sediment, usually because in the mangrove sediment, the degradation process is very slow, and thus they store huge amount of carbons and form carbon cells. Now coming to the journey of mangrove cell and mangrove foundation in the mangrove conservation. In 2012, mangrove cell was formed, from where the conservation of mangrove journey started. Then in 2014, there was a need to form another unit called Mumbai Mangrove Conservation Unit. Now this was specifically formed to remove the encroachments that were seen near the city area of the Mumbai. And it is a very proud thing that today over like more than 6,000 illegal hutments are removed from various Mumbai parts of the Mumbai. Not only this, after removal also there is a security force that is kept in the area, and it is ensured that no further encroachment will occur in this areas. Then in 2015, Mangrove Foundation was formed, and the main role of the Mangrove Foundation was also the marine and mangrove biodiversity conservation, sustainable livelihood activities, promote research, education and awareness. So along with Mangrove Cell and Mangrove Foundation, both this organization, they work parallelly to for one common motive, that is the mangrove conservation. So apart Mangrove Foundation and Mangrove Cell had also been pioneer in organizing this clean mangrove campaigns. We all know that most of the time, if you have traveled in the mangrove area, this is a very common view that you will see that mangroves, and you will see the entangled plastic bags and bottles near the mangroves. So what we give back comes back to us, and usually it comes back to our borders. And if our borders are not conserved, then probably it will cause situations like that we faced in 2006, and we have been facing every year, that is the Mumbai floods. So this initiative was started where 8,000 tons of solid waste was removed from the mangroves in Mumbai, and this also made its journey to the Limca Book of Record. So this journey of clean mangrove campaign, there were various stakeholders that were involved in this journey, from the colleges, from the corporates, and it is a very happy thing that today people are aware and they really want to participate in this initiative. It is a houseful initiative that is undertaken by the Cell and Foundation. Now talking about restoration programs. In the restoration programs, we have undertaken mangrove plantation along the various coastal districts of Maharashtra. So in the plantation of mangroves, the very important step is formation of mangrove nurseries. So I would like to brief you a little bit about how the mangrove nurseries are formed. The collection of seeds and propagule is the first step in the formation of mangrove nursery. And it is also a very crucial and important step in the formation of this nursery, because unlike other seeds that you can collect any time, in mangroves the seeds cannot be collected as per our time availability, but it has to be collected as per the high tide, low tide timings and many other aspects. So these are the different type of fruits that are seen in the mangrove species commonly. And this pod-like structure which you can see are actually the saplings. Here, because the soil is very unstable, the fruit, it germinates on the parent plant, and the green color pod-like structures that you see are actually the roots. And these tiny saplings, when they get matured, they will form small dots on it, and the color also changes, and then they are collected with the help of forest laborers. And similarly, at the same time, the polybags also are kept ready, filled with the sediment. Nurseries are done in the same area where the mangroves grow. It cannot be done on the terrestrial land. So nursery, we have to ensure that in the nurseries also high tide and low tide water influence is present. So here are a few pictures like how this will work in the nursery, and this is a picture of the nursery. Usually this propagules and the seeds, they are nurtured for 9 months in a nursery. And later on, the plantation process starts. So in the plantation process, very important step is formation of these channels. In the terrestrial plantation, usually we can give irrigation. We can give water by irrigation, but this will not happen in the mangrove areas, because mangroves will specifically need water that comes during the high tide. And if water is not available, whatever plantation is done, the survival percentage will be very low. So these type of channels are formed in a fishbone pattern to ensure that water reaches to the entire plantation site, and then the plantation process takes place. Now you can see the carrying of the saplings is also not easy. Saplings, like few saplings, are collected in the boats, and they have to take it on a head load, and then the plantation has to be done. So during the plantation also, in terrestrial, you must be aware that we dig the pits, but again, this is not possible over here because sediment is very unstable. Usually, as you can see in this picture at the bottom, a man is having a bamboo. With the bamboo, he will make a, he will dig a little bit of sediment, and the plantation will take place. So this is how the plantations are done. So whenever we undertake any plantation, it is ensured that the channels that are digged, they are maintained for 4 years, and the entire plantation is under observation for 7 years. So this ensures the survival of the plantation that is undertaken by our departments. So this is the picture of the 10 years old plantation. Initially, the mangrove growth that occurs, it is very slow. So it will take around 10 to 20 years for a full grown mangrove forest to form after the plantation is done. Now these are some of the facts and figures that you can see about the growth journey of the mangroves that along the coastline of Maharashtra. So according to the FSI report, that is Forest Survey of India report, it is clearly seen that in 2005, the mangroves were 158 square kilometer, and in 2019, sorry, it is written 2020 over here, it is 2019. So in the year 2019, it was 320 square kilometer. So this is somewhere like where you see that all these plantation programs that are being taken by the mangrove cell, mangrove foundation and various other stakeholders as is showing results, where you can see considerable increase in the mangrove cover. So in last 5 years, around 1480 hectares of plantation is being done by the department, where 65 lakhs saplings, like more than 65 lakh saplings are planted. And this year we have proposed to take 25 hectares of mangroves in the plantation, and we intend to plant 10 lakh saplings. So with this, I am done with explaining about the mangrove restoration activities. So after that, like, we also undertake many livelihood projects under the umbrella of mangrove cell and mangrove foundation. And we have with us Ms. Saili Gupte, who is livelihood specialist of Mumbai area from mangrove foundation. So I invite Saili and ask her to continue the presentation on livelihood development. Thank you, Sheetal. Now we will be looking into the livelihood development section of the Mangrove Foundation and Mangrove Cell. The scheme which we are talking about is Mangrove Conservation and Livelihood Generation, was launched in 2017 on 20th September. The reason behind launching this scheme was the project of a project funded by UNDP, that is United Nations Development Program, under which the Mangrove Cell has conducted different sustainable fisheries projects, which enlightened the capacity of mangroves as a good livelihood option. Thus, without destructing the mangroves, it can be used for the livelihood of the coastal communities. Considering the success of the project, the government launched this scheme for Maharashtra, and now it has been spread to all coastal districts of Maharashtra. The main objective of this scheme is the protection of mangroves on government as well as private lands. But no conservation can be done without including local communities in the conservation. As they live in the same area, they will be the key person in the conservation. Thus, the second main object of the scheme is to provide sustainable livelihood to the coastal communities, in turn, which will conserve the mangroves in their villages. Soon after the launch of the scheme, it received a lot of media coverage due to its success and the sustainable approach. As I mentioned, this is a government scheme, thus it has a pre-planned path by which it is done in each villages. For this, first the villages were surveyed by the project expert for the mangrove cover and the site selection for the aquaculture projects which can be done in that village. After that, the MCMC, that is Mangrove Co-Management Committee, was formed in the village, which includes 6 villagers and 1 forest department representative. This ensured the activity of the scheme run properly on the village level. Also, this MCMC look after the financial transaction related to these projects, the aquaculture projects. After the MCMC is formed, the beneficiaries were selected as per the mandate of the scheme. The scheme has mentioned specific criteria for beneficiary selection, which we followed while selecting the beneficiaries from the villages. Then these beneficiaries are trained for their different projects, as they will be doing different aquaculture projects. These trainings are done by the scientific institution, which are government organizations. Then the subsidy for this project is, for group project, it is 90% subsidy. And for individual projects, it's a 75% subsidy. This subsidy is not in the form of money, but in the form of material. As we are doing the livelihood activities in a more sustainable way, thus it requires advanced techniques and advanced machinery, which is provided by the government funds. Then at the end of the harvest, we also provide them the marketing skill training, as well as the market linkages, which help them to market their products and become self-sustainable. Now we will be looking at some successful projects under this scheme. Our first project is mudcrab farming. This project has 2 level rearing. First is nursery rearing. As you can see in the photograph, the pond is selected and the hapas, that is the mesh boxes,
are installed in the pond. The crab hatchlings are released in these boxes and are reared for 3 to 4 months until they reach this size. This size is called crablet size. These crablets are then released in the pen culture. In the photograph, you can see the mangrove area, which is fenced with the mesh, and a bamboo walkway has been made in the area. This area where the pen is constructed has to have the tidal influence, which give more good result in the crab culture product or harvest. This is the final size of crab which we harvest from our project, and it is getting good market value. Next is our fish culture project or fish cage culture projects. This project also has two stage rearing. The first stage is nursery rearing. This photo you are looking is from the Thane nursery of sea bass fish. Similar to the crab culture nursery, the hapas are installed in the ponds for fish culture, and the fishes are reared for 2 to 3 months until they reach this size, that is approximately 1 centimeter size of crab fish juveniles. These juveniles are then given to the next group for cage culture rearing, in which the cages of GI pipe are constructed at the sites with the local welders, which gives the livelihood to the local welders as well. Then the fishes are reared for next 4 to 5 months in these cages, and the harvest is done. The photo you can see is from the harvest site of from the Sindhudurg. Our next project is oyster farming and mussel farming. For these two projects, we use the rack and drain method, in which the bamboo raft has been constructed and the rope is tied to the bamboos and suspended in the tree. For specifically for oyster culture project, the empty shells of oyster are woven into the rope and are suspended in the creek area where the presence of oysters is already noted. As the seed of the oyster is not being fed at the site, but it is taken directly from the environment, as these empty shells give the place for the floating oyster seed to settle down, thus it requires 3 to 4 months until they be grown to this size. The raw oysters are then harvested from the sites. Many of our beneficiaries have earned good revenue from the sale of these raw oysters in this lockdown period. We also provide our beneficiaries with the value addition training, which in turn help them to prepare the oyster pickle in this lockdown period, which give additional revenue to the beneficiaries. Next is the mussel farming, in which the ropes are woven with the seeds of mussels. In this culture, we are not using the natural seed, but the seed from the scientific organization, where it is kept in a proper condition. These ropes are then tied to the bamboo raft and are kept suspended in the tree for 2 to 3 months until they reach until the full grown mussels are seen on the ropes. Then they are harvested and directly sold to the market. Our next project is ornamental fish rearing. This is the new project undertaken by the scheme. In this project, the clownfish, which is highly demanded after the release of film Finding Nemo, is reared in the hatchery. This hatchery is set up by the scientific organization at Coastal and Marine Biodiversity Center, Airoli. These are the fishes of marine environment that are difficult to keep and difficult to rear. Thus, for the first cycle, we have given in our beneficiaries, the freshwater fishes, which enable them to get through the techniques and the methods of the fish. Ornamental fishes, the harvest. Last, we have a specific, so come back to this session later. Going to the next session, I would like to inform you all that as we all know, this lockdown period has been frustrating for all of us, but for our beneficiaries is not frustrating, but it was more of a happiness and happy news, revenues and media coverage. As you can see on the slide, approximately 20 lakh revenue was earned from the state during this lockdown period from the harvest of the scheme projects. And these are some of the media coverage I'm showing you on the slide. So next we will be moving to the mangrove ecotourism section of the livelihood, for which I invite my colleague, Mr. Vandan Zaveri. He is Assistant Director of Ecotourism at Mangrove Foundation. Welcome, Vandan.
Thank you, Saibi, for the wonderful presentation. My name is Vandan Javeri and I am Assistant Director of Ecotourism in Mangrove Foundation. We are working for sustainable and community-based ecotourism along the coastal market. Travel ban. Don't we all hate this word currently? And I'm sure you all are waiting eagerly for center, which is in Airoli, which it was developed early in 2015. Along with a combined joint project with German government. It has state of the art technology and audiovisual panels to depict the biodiversity around it. It has various sections which shows you the intertidal zone and the marine biodiversity. They have touched us, and as well as in the Thanagiri Flamingo Sanctuary. It is also a gateway to the Thanagiri Flamingo Sanctuary, which happens to be the very first flamingo sanctuary in India. You can also take a boat ride over there, and when you take a boat ride, you can see the flamingos. So don't miss this chance. Flamingo do start coming somewhere in November and December, and we start our boat ride around that time. We have lots of local people employed at our Coastal and Marine Biodiversity Center, and over a period we have done various capacity building of them. So they are able to give proper knowledge, and they are able to create awareness amongst the visitors and the various schools who visit in these areas. Talking about the locals, let us start our main topic of the day, which is ecotourism. So key players in protection of any of the areas are local community. They have a symbiotic relation with the area where they are living for so long. And if you remove them from the equation, it is very difficult to conserve the areas. So we are trying to work along with the locals for the conservation of mangroves, which is the need of the. I'm sure you all know about the current cyclone and the flood situation which happened. Ecotourism initiative which we are promoting is it involves the local community. It will provide a means of alternative livelihood for all these locals, which is again very much important looking at the current situation where most of the people came from all these villages to Mumbai, and because of this current situation they all have to go back to their villages, and I'm sure they will definitely take help of this kind of schemes, government schemes. We are trying to promote low impact, low environmental impact initiatives, and small scale alternative for small scale alternatives of tourism destinations compared to the big known places. And not just that, it will be all these initiatives will be a community based conservation areas or hub where local people themselves will be able to educate the people who tourists who will visit their areas, and in turn they will create awareness amongst the tourists, and it will serve the purpose of initial conservation. It all started with this group of 8 ladies, I would say. This is from Bangalore Line Singular, as my colleague Saili mentioned earlier, in the United Nations Development Project early, like few years back, which was a joint project with of Mangrove Cell and UNDP. So this 8 humans, they were quite enthusiastic, and they started, they showed interest in taking up this ecotourism initiative along with other projects which we were implementing in that time, like other infrastructure projects. So they started learning about mangroves, and they even volunteered, like they even started to grow the boats. They when they are growing the boats, they take the tourists around in the narrow mangrove creeks of Mandi Creek in Bangalore. Not just that, later on they have also started various other add-ons to their mangrove trips, which would like caterings, catering service to the tourists who come there. And going a step ahead, they have also launched a range of products of their own. So similarly, looking at the success of those projects, it was decided to extend it to other coastal areas as well. So let us start with Sindhudurga itself. In Sindhudurga, it's well known. Tourist destination, it's known for its beach and water sports areas. But we are trying to promote some of the areas which is lesser known, has a good biodiversity, especially mangroves. To start the beautiful locations. But to start with, we have currently started our ecotourism and projects in Paramount, Pitmumri, Ashra, and Dimri. These all places have wonderful mangrove biodiversity, unique aesthetic values. The place you can actually walk inside. There are trails you can walk through inside the mangrove areas, and I'm sure you have listened to Sitil Madam earlier, and what she was explaining, all these locals people, they have reached that level that they are able to explain you each and every details of mangroves, how they grow, and other biodiversity which is found in that area. These are some of our other aquaculture project sites, which also you can visit as a part of ecotourism over there. And these are some of our locals who are taking tourists who are visiting in the areas around. They are explaining various aquaculture projects. They are explaining about the creatures found on the shore or about mangroves. Coming further north in Ratnagiri, we are currently Anjarle and Sonia, this two villages we are currently working in Ratnagiri. Anjarle, I'm sure you all must have heard, and even some of you might have also been there. It is famous for Turtle Festival, that is known as the Turtle Festival Village. But apart from that, there are beautiful areas, beautiful patch of mangroves there. As you can see from this picture, these all are from Anjarle. We have also introduced kayaking over there, where you can actually row your kayak into these narrow creeks of mangroves and see the mangroves from up close. You can experience the boating with locals. And when you are traveling in this mangrove creeks, you can see various biodiversities. Like you can see otters, you can see birds. Some of this mangrove tree also has a population of bats. Unnao is another area in Ratnagiri. It is not very well known compared to other places, but it is quite an inland area, not on the coastal area, but still it has a tidal influence. And there are mangroves, especially this one area, which is uncommon mangrove. It also has a very picturesque area. It's a less disturbed, it's not on a tourist map, so it is very pristine. You can make out from the picture. This picture is very interesting. You can see some gap between this mangrove areas, and it is made by a creature, which is this, a crocodile. So, yeah, Songa has good population. And crocodile, they nest in all this mangrove island. It could be a good thing together. If we are coming further north, we are currently started. We have started projects, ecotourism initiative in Kalinje and Biberagar. Kalinje is between Harihareshwar and Srivardhan. Both are very well-known places. Many of you must have been there. But Kalinje is not again a known places. Kalinje, we have trained a local group of groups for taking mangrove trails, boat safaris. You can spot oil like on a lucky morning, low tide. You can also spot smooth-coated otters over there. And in the picture, you can see a black-capped kingfisher, which is not very common. In Kalinje also, you can experience mangrove kayaking in shallow water areas, which is comparatively safe and guided by our trained people. So, no, we are training all these people. Will come to that part later. These are some of the pictures of bird diversity which you can find in Kalinje. This is the island of Kalinje, mangrove island of Kalinje. So, very lush green and thick mangrove vegetation, beautiful area. And you can't like you can see it from the shore outside from the mainland. And you can also go in on the island if you take a boat and can visit some of the nature things. On the island, and many trees have like there are coconut plantations on there. There are huge bat colonies. You take a boat ride in the evening, you can see like hundreds of bats coming out of the island, and other birds which were foraging throughout the day, they all are coming back to their roost. So you can experience this as well in that area. Tourist also experiences how we do the mangrove plantation. I'm sure like earlier Sheetal madam explained how we are doing the mangrove plantation. So we also give a chance to tourists who are visiting there, take a first hand experience to do all these activities. The picture in the center is very unique, which usually you will not get to see. The long thread like things which are running, rope like things which are running away from the mangroves, they are actually mangrove roots. The mangrove roots can go as long as about 25 to 30 feet from the main plant, which you can see easily here. Otherwise, it is hidden under the mud. Another village is Divyagar in Raigad, where we are working. Divyagar is also a very well-known tourist destination, but it's known for its water sports and beaches, but we are trying to divert people from this kind of pain to everyone. Like tourism from ecotourism, where they are also they can experience the nature in a different way and also learn about biodiversity and appreciate it. And eventually they will also want to save biodiversity. There are bird watching trails, there are shore walk you can take along with local people. And recently, earlier this year, we had taken a workshop for sky gazing training of Divyagar and Anzarle, those two villages. So, our local beneficiaries have shown tremendous interest and they have gained knowledge. And they have, in fact, also started taking the night star gazing trails. So during the daytime, we have lots of things to explore in mangroves, like boat safari, kayak, mangrove trails, bird watching. And in the night, if you visit any of this destination, you will be occupied even during the nighttime with various activities. We also train our beneficiaries. Like before starting this initiatives, we train our beneficiaries on various subjects so that they get the in-depth knowledge of the subject and they are confident enough to convey it to all this. Visitors who visit that area, which includes mangroves, marine biodiversity, ethics of ecotourism, which is very important, not to disturb the biodiversity, eco-friendly products, etc. We take this kind of indoor sessions, and we also take them out on the field for hands-on experience. This is a compiled list of all the villages, which are like many of them already started receiving the tourists before March. I would like to give an example of Kalunjay. In 3 months, December, January, and February, they earned around 30,000 to 40,000 rupees just by doing the tourism to the group of our beneficiaries. And other places also, lots of tourists are visiting slowly. I'm sure once we are also developing a standard operating procedure to be followed once this lockdown is relaxed and people can start traveling. Activities which most of these areas we are promoting is mangrove boat safari, nature walk, bird watching trips, mangrove walks, shore walk, tide pool exploration is something new. When during the low tide, when the water recedes, there are small rock patches where the water still remains, and you can find the colorful biodiversity like sea anemones, sea slugs, etc. I'm sure if you go there, you will enjoy this kind of trails. Visit to the aquaculture sites, which are like our other projects. And we also promote our beneficiaries. We also tell our beneficiaries to give kind of a package where they also take these villagers not just to this biodiversity area, but they can also take the tourists to nearby historic places of historical importance and heritage sites, so they can stay there for long. We also tell them to for a home, we encourage them to start homestays of their own, and thereby earning more revenues by this kind of activity. Many places when we were doing our training sessions, found that some of the local people have very interesting stories to tell about when they go out. Most of them are fishermen, from the fishermen community. So when they go out for fishing, incidents have happened, or even there are some old aged people, they have some old stories about the villages. So that also we are documenting, and I can assure you many of them are very much captivating. So when a tourist visits there, we just don't want them to be another tourist, but we want them to contribute to the science itself. There are various citizen science platforms. Some of them I have shown on the slide. So we tell them, we encourage them, even our beneficiaries or locals. And when the tourists go there, we encourage them to list down whatever biodiversity they have seen. Even a little, small things like butterflies or common birds, and they can upload it on this kind of social science project, citizen science project. So by uploading their sightings, they are actually helping creating a larger database of biodiversity which is found in that area. So and by doing so, even the visitors will get a sense of involvement in an actual science, actual science, not just being a regular tourist. So yeah, I'm sure you must have got some, you must have enjoyed this journey from Sindhudurg to all the way to Raigad. And definitely I would request you to visit all these places whenever possible, and encourage our beneficiaries so that they start conserving their area even more. With this, I would like to invite Mr. Virendra Tiwari, who is additional principal chief conservator of forest in Mangrove Cell, and also executive director of Mangrove Foundation. And I would request sir to enlighten us on various legal aspects of mangrove conservation.
Thank you, Vandan.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Am I audible? Yeah. Thank you.
Yes, sir, I think
already Dr. Sheetal has explained about how we do work in our nurseries and how we do our plantations. and already Saili has explained about various livelihood activities. And just preceding this talk, Vandan has already explained about what we are doing in the ecotourism aspect of the livelihood. Now, coming to the very important aspect, which is many people, they want to know about how the mangroves are protected. So, can we go to the next slide? Yeah. Now, explaining about the type of protection, let me first begin with the Maharashtra Tree Felling Regulation Act. So, this act was enacted in 1964, and in 1987, there was an amendment by which.
Sir, are you able to hear us?
Hello?
Hello? Sir, your Hello? Voice is not.
Yeah, is it okay now?
Okay, fine.
Is it okay?
Can you raise the camera a little bit?
Oh yeah, is it okay now? Hello? Is it okay? Can you hear?
Yes sir, you're audible.
Yeah. Okay.
Raise the camera a little bit.
I can see myself, but yeah. So what should I do it like this?
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Is it? Am I visible? It's okay, even if I'm not visible, at least if I'm audible.
So we can start.
Yeah. So what I was explaining was the Maharashtra Tree Felling Regulation Act of 1964. In 1987, an amendment was made into the schedule, and mangrove was added by giving some protection to it in the form of: if anybody wants to do any felling of mangroves, then permission of the government is required. So that time in 1987, it was the tahsildar who was tree forest officer. So for each felling of mangroves, so 13 species were included in the schedule, and permission of tahsildar was required. However, subsequently in 1989, the power of tree officer was given to range forest officer, and the same type of protection was given to mangrove as was given to chandan, teak, or many other, about 16 other species of trees. Then subsequently, one of the most landmark judgment, which is called Godavarman judgment, passed by Honorable Supreme Court on 12th of December 1996, was the first time when the Supreme Court asked to protect all the areas which are forest as per dictionary meaning. So earlier only those areas were given legal protection which were declared as reserve forest or protected forest under Indian Forest Act. So first time the court asked all the states to identify such areas which look like forest as per dictionary meaning. So the, in 1997, some mangroves of Mumbai suburban district, they were identified as per the Supreme Court order. Subsequently, in the year 2001, the Environment Department issued a circular giving some directions regulating the felling of mangroves. And we all know one of the most important judgment of the year 2005 in writ petition 87 filed by Bombay Environmental Action Group, whereby the High Court gave an interim order, and basically they gave four directions. First was to declare all the mangroves on government land as protected forest, to declare all the mangroves on private forest as forest, and it also directed that no dumping will be done on mangrove, and also there will not be any construction within 50 meters of mangrove unless the court permits. So this was one of the landmark interim order after which the foundation of mangrove protection started in the state of Maharashtra. And in the year 2008, state government declared some of the mangroves as protected forest. However, the state government on its own decided to give more protection to mangroves and decided to declare these mangroves as reserve forest instead of protected forest. This final judgment of this High Court order came in the year 2018. Before that, in the year 2013 to 2016-17, state government declared approximately 15,312 hectare as reserve forest under Section 4 of Indian Forest Act, and also appointed subdivisional officers as the inquiry officer. The subdivisional officers are supposed to carry out inquiry about claims, rights and claims over the land. And after all the claims are settled, the declaration is final declaration under Section 20 is done. And so far, approximately 1487 hectare area has been finally declared under Section 20. That means no rights exist on those land. Next, please. Yeah, then other act which give protection. Now, once an area is declared as Reserve Forest Act, as Reserve Forest under Indian Forest Act, the Indian Forest Act Section 26 becomes applicable. And if any violation, any felling of mangrove trees happen, or any dumping happens, or any encroachment happens, then offense can be registered under Indian Forest Act, and the proceedings can be started in the court. Now, another aspect remains that, see, out approximately we have about 32,000 hectare area under mangrove, out of which approximately 1700 to 1800 hectare are government land, and remaining is the private land. So not all mangroves are declared as reserve forest. Though majority, approximately about 15,000 we have declared, but still about 2,000 to 3,000 hectare area still remains to be declared as reserve forest under Indian Forest Act. And also there are more than 13,000 hectare mangrove on the private land. So issue is how to protect that area, or which act is applicable. So basically, unless and until any area is declared as reserve forest or protected forest, you cannot apply Indian Forest Act. So all the remaining areas which are not declared as reserve forest or protected forest, or are the private areas, then if any violation happens on, regarding mangrove on those areas, then Environmental Protection Act becomes applicable. So one thing which we all know, so whenever there is any destruction of mangroves, we do get all the complaints. They are received by the mangrove cell. So, but actually, the common people do not know these legal distinction. So basically, Forest Department is not empowered to act under or take cognizance of any violation under Environment Protection Act. Here, the Secretary, Environment, Pollution Control Board, collectors, and subdivisional officers. These are the only four authorities. They can take cognizance of any violation. And here, the offense is registered in police station under Section 15 of Environment Protection Act. And subsequently, the police department inquires and files charge sheet against the offender in the court. So this is the basic difference between area which is reserve forest or protected forest and the area which is not declared under Indian Forest Act. Also, then we have CRZ notifications under Environment Protection Act, which as per 2011 notification, all mangroves are CRZ 1, and for anything, any construction or any felling, if it has to be done, then we have to take permission of MCZMA. And also, once as I explained, as per the Goda Varman judgment, if any area, all mangrove areas which look, it basically it's a naturally grown area which looks like a forest, so all gets covered under Forest Conservation Act. So whenever any infrastructure is to be built whereby mangroves are being felled, the permission of the central government is required. So diversion orders are issued. Now, to understand how many, you see, as on now, we have so many protections. So any mangrove is to be felled, you require permission of MCZMA, because it comes under CRZ. It is also covered by Forest Conservation Act, so you require permission of central government. And then also, as the High Court has passed the order that you cannot do any dumping or any felling of mangrove. So for any, even after taking permission of MCZMA or central government, one has to file a petition in the High Court and seek permission of the High Court for felling of mangrove. And then High Court examines all the sanctions which are given by central government or MCZMA. And then only after all the conditions are met and the user agency has paid all the levies, then only the High Court permits felling of the mangroves. So this type of protection is given by various acts. Even the wetland rules, which are under Environment Protection Act, the rules of 2010, they even included mangroves under the definition of wetland. However, now the revised rule has been notified in the year 2017, whereby the definition, since it is already covered under CRZ 1, now the mangrove as such is not, all the areas which are declared as forests or sanctuaries, they are not, they do not come under the wetland rules. Now, to implement the High Court order, a committee has been constituted under Divisional Commissioner. This is by Government GR dated 16th October 2018. The High Court itself has directed as to who would be the members of the committee. Deputy Conservator of Forest Mangrove Cell is the member secretary. The committee includes all the collectors, all the district police officers, then all the planning authorities like municipal corporation, like CIDCO, MADA, then also the petitioners are included in the committee. Even pollution control board is a member. So, and this committee, all the complaints is submitted, which is received by this committee. The compliance is submitted to High Court every 3 months. I think almost every month the committee meets and reviews all the complaints, and even a grievance redressal mechanism as per the direction of the Honorable High Court has been devised. Government has issued a GR on 19th December 2018 for this grievance redressal mechanism. Anybody can make complaint on the website of the committee, and there is a WhatsApp group, and also Forest Department has a call center. Anybody can dial 1926 and lodge the complaint, and all the complaint cognizance is taken by the divisional level committees, and also we have district level committees under collector. So the complaints can also be lodged with the collector or the local forest officer, and action as per the either Indian Forest Act or Environment Protection Act is done. Then also to oversee the working of the divisional commissioners committee, we have a secretary level committee which is chaired by additional chief secretary revenue. It also has secretary forest and secretary environment. They are the members, and additional PCCF mangrove cell is member secretary of the committee. So this is in brief what are the legal protections which are applicable to mangrove, and the department is trying its best. Already it was explained that we have employed Maharashtra Security Guard Corporation guards to protect the sensitive areas. We are already constructing boundary walls so that the encroachments which are removed, they do not come back. And even in the lockdown period in Bhiwandi area, we seized one dumper, one JCB and one tractor which were attempting encroachment on mangroves. So these are the deterrents, and after the vehicle is seized, I would say for last 3 months nobody has even come forward to claim the vehicle. So because of the efforts by the department and the cooperation of the local NGOs and all the citizens, we are trying our best to protect mangroves. Thank you. Vandan.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Just a minute.
Oh, there was some issues here.
Sir, can we ask some questions, sir?
Yeah, sure. Sure. Yeah.
Sir, I'm Kamlesh Joshi. I'm an environment expert from Gujarat.
Yes, please.
Sir, as per the CRZ notification 2018,
yeah,
we need to keep buffer of 50 meter.
Yes.
If mangroves are mangroves density are 1000 square meter.
Yeah.
Sir, is it for naturally grown mangroves or some areas we find in Kutch area they have artificially grown the mangroves?
No, here in Maharashtra, in the recent judgment, they have not distinguished the minimum area which you were saying, ki 1000 square meter or so. And the Honorable High Court has said, irrespective of that, everything is covered.
Okay.
So irrespective of the patch size, even if there is a single mangrove tree,
okay,
and that 50 meter buffer is applicable. Okay. As per the High Court.
But sir, is it it should be a naturally grown mangroves or it is artificial?
Any mangrove. See, recently in the year 2020, I think in the month of May, they have issued some amendment to CRZ rules where, okay, there were many claims that this was not originally mangrove and the bund got broken. And water came in and the mangroves come up. The court has said even those are covered under CRZ 3A. So some people used to call it inland mangrove. Hai na? So even the very recently, the amendment in the May 2020, it says even nothing can be done on those mangroves also.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Any more questions?
Thank you so much, sir. That was a wonderful presentation. I would also like to thank our team, Mangrove Foundation and Mangrove Cell, of Mangrove Conservation. We will be inaugurating our virtual tour of Coastal and Marine Biodiversity Center, Airoli. I would like to request Tiwari sir to please inaugurate the virtual tour.
Yeah. So here it is.
Thank you so much, sir. I would like to invite participants to please visit the link and go through the virtual tour of the center. Thank you so much to all of you for attending the session, and I wish you all the happy Mangrove Conservation Day. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
हमारे स्क्रीन पे कोई हानि की बदलाव तो हमारे
स्क्रीन कोई बड़ी सी नहीं है अगर भाई हम